Hi!
Hi!
We're back. We're back after dinner. Sanji made us spaghetti. It was amazing.
Indeed.
It was the least he could do after kind of almost killing Robin.
Yeah, and running amongst the countryside, so yeah. Actually, can you imagine what... real talk for a second. Can you imagine what the hell Sanji would be doing in his downtime after the frenzy style was under the control of it?
I imagine him being him, he would kind of want to learn how desperately to control it and use it. For lack of a better term.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. He'd probably just be more of the usual, just try and just go between varsity and girls. It'd just be like purple aura around him.
Alright, let's go. He equipped the violet Saiyan aura from BT3. And this time, who will I go with?
Or the Dark Aura from Raging Blast, the only aura in that game that was really good to look at.
I don't know, I like the pink aura.
Yeah, that's alright. I don't know, I find Majin Vegeta's aura to be really good. Hey, it's me, Twitch.
I figure I should probably give him a shot at some point or another.
I think it was this game that you could technically use R2 to cancel the end of the square attacks.
Yeah, you could R2 cancel.
That's really cool. That's very good for like putting an enemy very close to you. Don't skip too fast. I know we're close to the end of this, dude, but still gotta let the audience at least see the shit they had to deal with.
I try. Perspective in this game is fucking weird. He doesn't seem that much taller than them.
Even though he is the quote-unquote half-giant.
Yeah, even the anime is pretty inconsistent. They don't know if they want to make him 12 feet tall or 25, and yes, that does make a difference.
Yeah, generally. I especially saw that in his quote-unquote fight against Teach. For one scene, he was like 12 feet tall. The next scene, he was like just several stories above Teach.
Now, would you get the most prime example of that is actually his first appearance when one of Shanks' men is actually delivering him a letter telling Ace not to go after Teach.
Oh, yeah, no, he... Oh, my God, he was like...
He was like 30 feet tall.
He was like five Shanks stacked on top of each other. Also, it's strange that...
Is that the main theme of the game playing in the background here? Yeah.
I think it is, yeah.
Yeah, that's the main theme of the... Wow, they want to get this game over with as fast as I do.
Yeah. Holy shit. Also, a strange thing upon hindsight when you think about it, that... one of the main cruxes of this game is Whitebeard, and Whitebeard is essentially the main character. And yet somehow it is still this boring. How's that happen? I don't know. Anyway, so I should probably briefly describe this mission, since I do remember the last few chapters pretty vividly. The idea is basically, the Marines are under siege from the French dial dudes, and we just have to go save them and try to recruit them onto our side. And oh my god, Sanji's DLC epic, I keep forgetting about it. It looks fine overall, but oh my god, the code part is so fucking huge. I didn't even know you had that extension, holy crap.
I'd more like the ridiculous trombone guns on his belt.
Didn't he use them like once in the movie and then never again?
That's how it goes both in Z and Strong World. Everyone comes in guns blazing, but they use them for one attack, just to be flashy, hidden, with the aim of stormtroopers, and then they just throw them away.
Yeah.
They did that same thing in film Strong World. They all busted into the room together. They used them for one attack, and then they didn't do anything.
I remember that one time when Robin first appeared on the ship that Sanji held a gun to her head. I was like, what? No legs?
No legs? Oh, yeah. That took me a second. Well. Nah, I can't come up with anything to defend that scene. The first thing that came to my mind was maybe if he's using a gun, he's not attacking them directly. He can't... Because his thing with chivalry that almost gets him killed way later is that the chivalry that... fuck, what was his name? Mentor dude, the old guy.
Really?
No.
Oh.
His...
Not even caught, right?
No. No, the real one.
Oh, yeah. Shit, I don't know.
Zeph! That Zeph was teaching him something about you can't ever hit a woman. So, good on him, I guess, but that would end up causing problems later on.
Yeah.
When he would end up having to quote-unquote, fight the only woman in CP9.
I'm getting some distinct flashbacks from Shiro right now. That's just me.
See, the difference is that Sanji's conviction actually makes sense.
Oh, Jesus. I haven't seen that before.
Yeah, that would be his second Musou.
That would be his second Musou, right? Wow, I didn't even know he did that guy access to the Skywalk in this game. Well, shit.
Yeah, Skywalk is not good. Well...
It's R2?
Yeah.
Huh.
This is his R... Alright. Clear out of this area.
You got Sanji, you're more than equipped to deal with it.
There's a Skywalk. Yeah, run upwards for a couple of seconds.
I wish it gave you a hell of a speed boost. That'd be really nice.
What I wish was that was his running animation.
Yeah. 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 I'm just gonna slide here really fast and do something quick.
Oh. Whoops.
Yeah, that was me.
Also, this is not gonna matter at all, like at all in 3. But in 2, you always want to kill all the base commanders because they spawn way more enemies than they should have any right to.
Yeah. Easy target practice, but goddamn.
Yeah. So.
That would matter for something if weren't level 50 already.
No, but it's just a matter of if you're too far away from a certain area, the potential chance that they could end up taking it back.
Yeah. Also, I do really like the new animation for his base Musou. It actually leaves like a grill mark in the floor. That's a really cool touch. I like that.
What kind of steak is that that has the actual grill marks in it? I don't think I've ever had that kind of steak before.
So not well done, but not rare, because that's like underdone. Fuck, I don't remember.
Rare done is when red meat is actually still red.
Yeah. I usually just get my shit medium rare.
That's really?
I think it's medium, actually.
I don't know why, but for some reason you strike me as someone that would go pretty much exclusively well done. If not actually...
I like the texture, but I'm not a big fan of taste. I like to have some juice still in my steak.
Me, funny enough, I actually like to have a lot of my food burnt.
I hate one of those guys.
Yeah, I don't know what it is. I can't eat, like, chicken, for example. I just can't eat that unless it's burnt. Something about it just doesn't taste right unless it's like burnt to a crisp.
No, chicken's like the de facto tastes like chicken. That's where it came from chicken.
No, I know though, but like,
is it the texture?
Yeah, something about it. If it's not burnt, it feels a little soft.
Yeah, I guess I'm kind of the same way, but like with like hard stuff. This is gonna sound really fucking stupid. But while we're on the subject, I have like this weird thing where I can't eat like really hard vegetables, like raw vegetables, because for some reason if I eat and it's like really hard and crunchy, it can really it gets my gag reflex. I don't know why.
Like celery or something?
Yeah, like not really celery, but like tomatoes.
Tomatoes a hard fruit or hard vegetable?
It's got a lot of juice to it.
Yeah.
I don't know why, but for some reason that whenever I do that, just onions. Oh my god, fuck onions.
Yeah. Well, onions are disgusting in general.
Onions are like the equivalent of Satan's asshole. No, thank you.
Yeah, but in terms of tomatoes, though, that's why the only ones I can ever have are... the only time I can ever eat tomatoes on something is if it's Roma tomatoes. The ones that are diced up and put on top of things.
Cherry tomatoes are okay. I like those.
Yeah, there are. The ones I just don't like are the ones that are really just sliced.
Yeah. But yeah, like, it's this weird thing I have with vegetables. It just always gets my gag reflex. Unless it's like... pressure cooked and it was like canned, I just can't eat it. It's very strange. I even forced myself to try to eat broccoli once, and I was just like, I'm literally about to gag. No, thank you.
I never understood, like, canning vegetables.
It's for preserving them and giving them, like, a different texture. And also being hella cheap with shipping expenses also. Because why would you pay a certain amount of money for shipping one amount of, like, I don't know, like, spinach or something. I do like spinach, though, funny enough. Do that for, like, a box, whereas you can just ship it in, like, a tiny little can. Basically.
I would think that the cost of aluminum would be higher than the cost of cardboard.
It's more like shipping area and space.
Huh.
I don't think there's any real shipping taxes for metals.
Yeah, if you're talking about just pure weight, though, I still assume that aluminum would be more expensive to ship than cardboard in terms of just weight.
Is it just me, or is it a really thing that we're talking about food while we're playing a Sanji? Why not?
I was trying to be topical.
Yeah, very topical, yes.
Also, since the stage doesn't really seem to want to move, I've killed all the bases. I've killed all the pacifistas that I believe are in the area.
Are we waiting for those guys to get to the bases? I don't know. Both these places are closed off.
Yeah.
Help Whitebeard reach... Yeah, it is. Okay, we are just... Kizar's not on our team yet, is he? Oh, yeah, that's right, because we're helping the Marines right now. It's later on he becomes an asshole. So basically becomes regular again.
Well, that's not his fault. And to this game's credit, this stage actually is one of my favorite cutscenes in the game.
I don't know, man. I've seen the shit he did in Archipelago. I have no idea how to pronounce that right now.
Subodri Archipelago.
That one. He seems a bit like a dick.
But no, he is a dick. That's why it's actually funny though. He's an asshole, but he's a funny kind of asshole. Akainu is the kind of asshole that you're just meant to hate.
Yeah. Like, it's like really just like strictly one-dimensional asshole.
He's a one-dimensional.
They make no secrets about it.
Akainu is one-dimensional just asshole for the sake of being asshole. Kizaru has fun with it. He's actually kind of a sarcastic asshole.
Yeah.
Which is actually part of what makes him slightly entertaining. I still don't like him, but at least he's mildly entertaining.
And he has still yet to see any scenes in post time skip besides, you know, playing Z. But yeah.
Well, he actually did appear in that chapter I was talking about earlier where they introduced
Whitebeard's son. Yeah.
Which actually that just came to me because it's so incredibly dumb and forgettable. His son's name is Edward Weebles. So I guess Edward is his last name.
Remember that character from Yu-Gi-Oh! Called Weevil? Okay.
No, Weevil with a B, not Weevil as in the ticks.
Yeah. I'm sorry, but that kid's destined to get
picked. W-E-E-B-L-E, not W-E-A-V-I-L-S.
No, that's a kid who's gonna get picked on, it's cool. No wonder he became an asshole.
Oh yeah, that reminds me. On that note, a new episode of Yu-Gi-Oh! Bridge came out like yesterday.
It did, and
for the first time like this year.
Yeah, I know. Well, Little Korea's been having some problems with this pooper lately, so yeah.
I know. You know what the best?
It's just funny because he's just openly making fun of it in some of his videos. You can't poop right, Doctor. How much time do I have? No, you just can't poop right.
Do you know what's the funniest part about that episode for me?
What was it?
The fact that Yugi openly makes a joke about Professor Hawkins getting his degree in archaeology
from the University of Arizona.
From the University of Phoenix. And if it wasn't for the
online.
Fact...
Online.
And if it wasn't just for the fact that we basically live in Phoenix... My mom used to work for University of Phoenix. My mom used to work for University of Phoenix.
I think mine did too, but she was like an intern there.
And speaking of someone that's seen the effects of University of Phoenix, I can guarantee you with 100% certainty, it's a worthless degree.
Any of you represent?
Actually, yes, because my sister went...
Because your sister goes there, too.
My sister went to NAU for undergrad and graduate school.
Nice.
And she got her master's in criminal justice or something at the age of 22.
Fuck, she got her master's at 22.
Yep.
Damn.
This is one of my favorite scenes in the game. What do you get? What happens when you cross light with lightning?
A really strange fanfiction.
Also, for some reason, despite the fact that Eneru is supposed to be on the moon right now. But that's the least of this game's geographical problems.
Except I got rubber. Kind of forgot that in the God damn it, I'm like brain dead right now.
Well, to be fair, rubber...
In the contract for being a god, you forgot that little part. Okay.
To be fair, rubber doesn't exist in the sky. Literally, rubber did not exist in Skypia.
I know. Like, what the fuck is this material?
Which is why it's actually pretty hilarious.
Did you ever use style gauge in this story? Or in this chapter? Because I remember you doing it once.
Not in this stage, no. It's one of those things that I sort of forget I have. That was the same problem I had during my first... run through of Pirate Warriors 3 was that I barely remembered I had the keys in the gauge, and it wasn't until I actually completed the story that I realized, oh wait, to get most of the coins, I actually have to go and use that and do a bunch of shit with the keys in the gauge in every single stage.
Not me, I'm usually abusing the fuck out of the style gauge in this.
To get an S rank in any given stage in Pirate Warriors 3, you have to kill at least 1,000 enemies per stage with just your keys in the gauge. And you also have to kill at least 2,000 enemies total. And you also... God damn it, Whitebeard. That can't take a hit for shit.
I wish your level 2 moveset was you touring Super Saiyan. That'd be really nice.
I would, but he ran away.
No, I mean just in general.
Ah. Well, no, at that point he's going Super Saiyan 2.
I'm okay with this.
Yeah. And it, the other thing to get it is that you need to make sure that you kill the final boss of the stage with it, with your Kuzuna Rush Musou. And that's actually...
You have to do it?
Yes, and that's more difficult than you'd think.
God damn it.
Because again, like I said, you can damage enemies literally just by triggering your... Damn it, I don't have enough. But just...
Give it a second. You can literally see it rising as we speak. And...
Give it a second.
Ta-da!
Yeah, you see that tiny bit, that tiny sliver of health that Sentomaru lost? Yeah, that's a lot more when done with the Kizuna Gauge. So there is a chance you can kill them just by triggering your Kizuna Gauge. Just by triggering the Kizuna Rush. So it's more annoying than you think, and there are chances are, if you're not paying absolute attention to everything that's going on, you may end up having to do a stage 3 times.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, guys, this is what happens when you use a character as an assist and they're not actually playable. Yeah, that just kind of happens.
They just come out and do a random Musou attack. Magellan's playable in the next game, and he's slow. He's slow, but he's pretty cool.
Slow enough to make Brandon gag.
No, that's not your spaghetti coming back up.
Ah, yes.
Goes down smooth, comes up rough.
It was so good, I got to taste it a second time.
Oh, Sanji and your Francophile names.
Francophile names?
Do you know what a Francophile is?
Not a fucking clue.
It's someone that's obsessed with French.
Oh. Okay. Actually makes total sense to me.
It does or doesn't?
Does.
Because all of his names are French.
Hi, Pacifista. Bye. Oh, hey, he's back. He came out and he was like, wait, is it... Oh, my God. Is it my turn in the script yet? Yeah? Oh, no? Okay, I'll go back. Wait, it is? Oh, shit.
Make up your mind. Oh, hey, he's up at Whitebeard. Oh, okay,
good. Whitebeard, why? Oh, it's Garp.
Okay.
Dude, surprisingly more fast than I thought he was going to be. I looked into it. Turned down being promoted to Admiral multiple times. I'm like, fuck.
Because he just doesn't want to deal with the responsibility.
I can respect that.
I wouldn't want to deal with that sort of paperwork either.
I wouldn't want to have to sit next to a Kaino, honestly. Fuck that. Yeah, can you imagine having to stare at Kizaru all the time?
And yeah. that's why Kuzan left.
Exactly.
Because Canon confirmed.
What wasn't because... It was because of that fight or anything. He just got fucking sick of looking at Kizaru all the time.
Oh, Unlimited World Red, your day is coming soon. We talk about how ugly he is here, and he is, but you need to experience Unlimited World Red.
Kizaru under cell shading.
Damn it, Magellan.
Imagine that. Usually cell shading makes people look amazing, but... Not the Italian man.
See, that's the funny thing, though, is that... When I was first seeing pre-release trailers... For Unlimited World Red, I thought graphically it looked amazing. I thought, honestly, the first thing that came to mind when I first saw it was Wind Waker.
Yeah, exactly. I love cell shading. But, as it turns out, it's a little too colorful, a little hard in the eyes.
It doesn't always work out for the best.
The color balance is just a wee bit off.
Yeah.
Yeah. And as a guy who is aiming to do professional video editing, that's a big pain in the ass.
Dude, if...
He's out of there. He ain't having none of that shit. He is God, after all.
Don't you dare. And he's
Is
gone.
He even there? He's still there. I think. Yes. I felt that one.
Bye.
That was one where he just knew he was trying to make a statement.
Little close there. There we go.
Well, not quite as much chest hair as Kyoraku, though. It's my defining characteristic. Sure. Like everything else you have.
When did he say that again?
Last chapter. It was when he was seeing off the Now.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And she was like, if you die, I'll shave off all your chest hair, dude. That's like my defining characteristic.
No, I think she. I thought she said she was gonna tear it off.
No. No, I just specifically remember on the Manga Panda translation, she said shave it off. I'm not sure which is worse, actually. Oh, wait, is this it? This is what I think it is. Oh. Oh, I thought it was going to be his wanted poster.
See, for some reason, I thought it would be a picture of Ivankov.
I...
To bring back the hell memories.
Does anyone else here just... We're just, like, writing ideas for things he could do to pick off the ground. Wanted poster, Ivankov.
Duval.
Yeah. The dude who actually looked like the character, how he was drawn. yeah, so beat the shit out of, helped him, admirals up. That was cool. Except, this Tully isn't gonna buy any NES later on or anything, right?
What?
This Tully isn't gonna buy any NES or anything, right?
Nope.
Also, this is like the one chapter where I actually fucking allies. Not even a chapter, this is like the one cutscene. I don't think I have to spell this out for you guys, but pirates and admirals, especially Akainu, don't get along well.
Just... You're gonna love the final episode.
I don't think it's really spelling anything if I'm literally spelling out 2 plus 2 and everyone's thinking in the crowd.
You know, I would figure that Akainu was secretly evil the entire time.
I don't really say secretly evil, he just couldn't get along with everyone. He doesn't play nicely.
But even in this game, which is why it reminds me of one of my favorite, most redundant quotes ever from the Nostalgia Critic during his review of the Shyamalan movie, The Devil. Oh my god, the devil was the devil! It's like, Akainu was evil? Really?
Mm. Oh man, I actually thought this was really cool dynamic.
Huh?
I actually thought the whole bounty thing on him was a really cool dynamic.
Hmm.
But do we even know what the hell he had a bounty on him for?
Who now? Smoker?
Yeah.
No, because the game doesn't tell us. Because this game doesn't really like details.
I think it was something having to do with, like, him knowing the existence of the Frenzy Dials or something.
I think it had something to do with helping Luffy. Because he was with Luffy, like, the entire game.
That is actually true, yeah. Look, there's not one browsing Tumblr between the two of us while I'm not looking at anything. What the hell's going on here?
That should say something about the story of this game. Well, upside, at least I'll have something to do in a couple minutes. We're coming up on that stage. Arguably the worst stage in the game.
One that's certainly given me a fuckload of fun.
You want to tell your story?
Alright, I'll tell my story then. Okay, so, when I first played this game, I was under the assumption that, Brandon was specifically telling me, don't kill Whitebeard. I was like, alright. Waited for literally 20 minutes first time, nothing suggesting there was gonna be something else after the cutscene happened. And I was like, okay, shit. So I killed him, got the regular ending, and I was like, alright, how the hell do I get the other ending? So I decided to go back, wait longer, didn't work, so I'm like, shit, I just wasted an hour of my life, again. So then I'm like, alright, how the hell, I casually started playing... the character missions. I was like, alright, maybe this will get me somewhere. I looked at GameFAQs, you have to beat every single fucking character mission in the game in order to actually get him. Or at least the ones that are immediately available, which is more or less all of them.
It's all of them except for Teach and the pre-time skips.
Yeah. So basically all of them. And I was like...
All but 10 of them.
I was like, Jesus fucking Christ, I thought unlocking Sasuke with Shining on Cost Engine 2 was a pain in the ass, but no. This takes the cake. So yeah, that's my history. It takes a day or two of grinding to get to that point.
Yeah, but like Jumanji, that's doing like 55 different individual 10 to 20 minute character missions.
Exactly. You're just saying that Clash Ninja 2 at least you were doing something. Exactly, that's what I'm saying. This shit's all over Clash Ninja 2.
Fun, though.
At least you're actively keeping your brain engaged by doing overrun mode. This game. Fuck.
At least that game was fun, though.
Once you select once you know that either Kuzan, Mihawk, Eneru, or...
Luffy.
Luffy too. As soon as you know they're, like, fucking gods here, you're just done. You've already beaten the game. Law. That's the character I forgot. So, with that being said, personal bias is not... I still can't choose Whitebeard. Well, I guess Whitebeard's not getting love in this game.
Well, what... I mean, given the stage...
Yeah, given the stage, too. Alright, you know what? Let's have no qualms, and there's no holding anything back. Let's have a fucking party. Unfortunately, he can't choose his main, Eneru, because he's kind of in the stage.
Alright, who should I be then? Who are you going to be?
I'll be Mihawk.
Alright, I'll go Law then. Law doesn't... Whatever, it doesn't matter who's not in the stage. Law shows up in the next stage.
Yeah. I'll choose Law later. Right now, I'm just going to stick to the Buzzsaw himself.
We have a Buzzsaw. His name is Mr. One.